Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. This next ayah, which the Shaykh quotes from Surah Al-Qasas and the statement of Qarun, إِنَّمَا أُوتِيتُهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ عِنْدِي. I have only been given it because of the knowledge which I possess. This is similar to, as Allah Jalla wa'ala says, also in the Qur'an, إِنَّمَا أُوتِيتُهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ بَلْ هِيَ فِتْنَةٌ وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. I have only been given it because of knowledge, but rather it is only a fitna or a trial, but most of them do not know. So the shahid from this ayah is that the person is giving himself the credit that he has this wealth because of his own knowledge, and that it's nothing to do with Allah Jalla wa'ala, and he doesn't acknowledge the fact that this is from the grace of Allah. Another tafsir of this could be that the person is saying that I have this wealth because of knowledge, meaning to say that Allah has the knowledge that I am worthy of it. So again, he's giving himself the credit, and he's not saying that this is from the grace of Allah and I don't really deserve this wealth. And this is similar to the statement of Mujahid when he says, "Uditu ala sharaf." He gave the explanation as that this person says, I have been given this because of my nobility, meaning I have a high status in society, so this is why this has been given to me, I am worthy of it. So when a person makes a statement like this, he is denying the fadl or the grace of Allah on him. So he's saying that there is no grace that Allah has bestowed upon me, but rather Allah has given me this because I myself am worthy of it, and Allah knows this, this is why He gave it to me. So however you look at the ayah, and whichever of the two tafaseer you take, the point is the same, he is not thankful to Allah Jalla wa'ala for this ni'mah which he has. And the reality of the matter is, whatever ni'mah you have, it is from Allah Jalla wa'ala, and it is not purely from your skills and qualifications. Many people have skills and qualifications, but they do not enjoy the same type of ni'mah, because it is simply not in their taqdeer, meaning what Allah has destined for them. And he says in Surah An-Nahl, ayah 53, وَمَا بِكُم مِّن نِعْمَةٍ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ إِذَا مَسَّكُمُ الدُّرُّ فَإِلَيْهِ تَجْأَرُونَ. And whatever blessings you have, it is from Allah. And then if some harm touches you, then you cry to Him for help. So credit must never be given to your skills and your knowledge, because whatever skills and your knowledge you have is also a ni'mah from Allah. So if your skills and your knowledge were a cause for you to gain your wealth, then you need to know that your skills and your knowledge are also a ni'mah, because not everyone has been given the same skills and knowledge as you. So either way, you have to give full credit to Allah and thank Him. So the point about a shukr, or being grateful, is that it has three essential ingredients. Number one, you have to acknowledge this ni'mah in your heart, that this is in fact a grace from Allah Jalla wa'ala. As we find in the story of Sulaiman alayhi salam, when one of the jinn who had the knowledge of the book, he brought to him the throne of the queen of Saba before Sulaiman could even blink his eye. And so when he saw the throne in front of him, he said, هَذَا مِن فَضْلِ رَبِّي لِيَبْلُوَنِي أَأَشْكُرُ أَمْ أَكْفُرُ وَمَنْ شَكَرَ فَإِنَّمَا يَشْكُرُ لِنَفْسِهِ وَمَنْ كَفَرَ فَإِنَّ رَبِّي غَنِيٌّ كَرِيمٌ. This is from the grace of my Lord to test me, will I be grateful or ungrateful? And whoever is grateful, then he is so to his own credit. And whoever is ungrateful, then Allah is rich, meaning to say he does not need anyone to thank him, and kareem, most bountiful or kind. So look how Sulaiman alayhi salam gives full credit to Allah Jalla wa'ala, that this is only from the grace of Allah, and that this is a test also to see if he will be thankful or not. And this is from the wisdom which Sulaiman alayhi salam was given, and in him there is an example for us to follow when it comes to all the ni'mah which we enjoy in life. The second ingredient is that you have to praise Allah with your tongue. So the first one was with your heart, and now secondly you have to praise Him with your tongue, and this is also part of you being thankful. Then the third ingredient is, you have to work righteousness with your limbs, meaning physical actions, those actions which will please Allah. So you giving thanks is done in three ways, with the heart, with the tongue, and with the limbs. So upon this, if you are given some ni'mah, and you feel inside yourself that this ni'mah came to you because of your own skills, or your knowledge, or your dexterity, then you are not grateful to Allah Jalla wa'ala, because you have not fulfilled the first condition, which is the acknowledgement in your heart that this ni'mah is from Allah solely, and it is from His grace, nothing to do with you. Likewise, if with your tongue you say that this ni'mah came to you because of such and such a person, because of your own skills, then you have not praised Allah, hence you are ungrateful. Similarly, if with your actions, after receiving the ni'mah of Allah, you perform evil deeds which do not please Allah, then again you have not been grateful, because the third condition of a shukr is missing. So it is only when all of these three conditions of ash-shukr are in place, can it hold true that you are ash-shakir, one who is grateful. Allah Jalla wa'ala says, اعملوا آل داود شكرا وقليل من عبادي الشكور. Work, O family of Dawood, giving thanks, and only a few of my slaves are thankful. Let us now take a look at this next evidence, found in Sahih al-Bukhari, on the authority of Abu Hurairah radiallahu an, that the Prophet ﷺ said, as he told his companions of a story about three people from Bani Israel. And just take a note here, that all the stories which are in the Qur'an and the authentic Sunnah, then the intention behind narrating these stories is not that they make for ideal bedtime stories for your kids, but rather there is a lesson and admonition in them. These stories could consist of mistakes which the previous nations made, which we must avoid and take lesson from. Or they could include some good actions which the previous people did, which we can take as an example and follow. So either these stories are encouraging us to do something good, which the previous people did, or warning us against falling into the same mistakes as the previous people did. Allah Jalla wa'ala says in Surah Yusuf, Ayah 111, لَقَدَ كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ عِبَرَةٌ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. There was in their stories an admonition for a people of sound intellect. So this is the aim behind all the stories in the Qur'an and the authentic Sunnah. And from the stories of the authentic Sunnah is this one. The Prophet ﷺ said, Allah wanted to test three people from Banu Israel. One was a leper, one was a blind man, and the other was a bald man. First of all, Banu Israel, the children of Israel. Israel is the name of Ya'qub alayhi salam. So the children of Ya'qub alayhi salam, meaning from his descendants, they are Banu Israel. Ya'qub alayhi salam is the son of Ishaq alayhi salam, who is the son of Ibrahim al-Khalil alayhi salatu wasalam. As for the leper with the skin disease, the ulama say that this disease, it is not possible to cure it in the absolute sense. There will always be this skin disease on you. Perhaps it may stop spreading, but to remove it in totality is not possible. And so this was one of the miracles of Isa alayhi salam, is that he would touch the leper and cure him in totality. And this was a miracle and a sign for Bani Israel. Allah Jalla wa'ala says about the favors he bestowed on Isa alayhi salam, وَتُبْرِئُ الْأَكْمَهَ وَالْأَبْرَصَ بِإِذْنِي. And you would heal the one who was born blind and the leper with my permission. He would wipe over them and they would be healed. And wiping is masah. So this is why he's called Al-Masih. Comes from masaha, to wipe. And the other man was bald and the other was blind. So Allah Jalla wa'ala sent to each of these three men an angel. The word for angel, malak, and the plural is malaika. These are from the unseen. Allah Jalla wa'ala has created them from light, and He has created them such that they never disobey Allah and always worship Him and carry out His commands. They do not eat nor drink, but rather they just make tasbih and prayer and dhikr of Allah by day and by night, and never suffering fatigue in doing so. And from the malaika are those who have specific jobs and duties which Allah has assigned them. And all of this is well documented in the Qur'an and authentic Sunnah. Anyone who denies the existence of the Malaika is a kafir outside the fold of Al-Islam, because Malaika are one of the pillars of Iman. The word Malak comes from Mal'ak, but the Hamza has been removed. And Mal'ak in turn came from Ma'lak, but the Hamza and the Alif were swapped around. And the word Ma'lak takes its roots from the word Aluka, which means al-risala, message. So the malaika are messengers of Allah Jalla wa'ala. So this malak came to the leper and he said, what would you like the most? He replied, I would like a good skin, because people feel averse to me, because he was a leper. So the angel touched him and his illness was cured, and his skin was given a good color and it was made beautiful. Then the angel asked him, what kind of property would you like most? He replied, camels or cows. The narrator Ishaq was not sure as to exactly what he said. And so he was given this, and the angel said to him, may Allah bless you in it. Note here that the angel touched him or wiped him, and his illness was cured, much in the same way as Isa alayhi salatu wasalam would do to his people. Was it necessary for Allah Jalla wa'ala to order the angel to touch him so that Allah could cure him? Could Allah not heal him without the touching? The answer is, of course He could, but the way Allah works is that He provides a sabab or a cause for everything. So the healing was with the permission of Allah, no doubt, and the cause was the angel wiping him. In the same way how the sea opened up for Musa alayhi salam, as Allah Jalla wa'ala told Musa to strike the sea with your stick. So this striking with the stick was a cause for the water to part. Otherwise, it is not necessary for Allah to have Musa hit the water with his stick. Allah could have done it without. But this is the point, that Allah makes a cause for everything. So this leper was given a pregnant she-camel, which was about 8, 9 or 10 months pregnant. Then the angel went to the bald-headed man and he asked him the same question, "What would you like most?" And he said, "I would like to have some good hair, because a people feel repulsion for me." So the angel again wiped him and he was given some good hair. And the angel asked him, "What property would you like the most?" And he replied, "Cows or camels." Again the narrator was in doubt, but it appears he was given a cow, because this is what the angel gave him. And then he said to him, "May Allah bless you in it." Then the angel went to the blind man and the same question, "What would you like most?" And he said, "I would like to have my eyesight restored so that I may see the people." So the angel touched his eyes and lo and behold, his eyesight was restored. Then he asked him, "What wealth would you like the most?" And he replied, "Sheep." And thus he was given a pregnant sheep. And the angel said, "May Allah bless you in it." Meaning, may Allah bless this wealth of yours. So may it grow and do you much good. The word barakah, which means blessing, comes from birka, which means a pond, because it is a place which has much water in it. And this is what barakah is, much goodness, which stays with you. Because in a pond, you have much water and it doesn't go anywhere, it is just staying there. So when you have much goodness from Allah Jalla wa'ala, meaning His ni'mah, and it stays with you, so it is not lost, then this is barakah. Otherwise, you can have millions of pounds, but you might lose it all in debt or some natural calamity. So there is no barakah in this. So the story goes on. Afterwards, all of the pregnant animals which these three men were given, they gave birth to their young ones, and the animals multiplied such that one of the three men had a whole valley of camels, the other one had a whole valley of cows, and the other one with a whole valley of sheep. Then the angel, disguised in the shape and appearance of a leper, came to the leper. And this is the man who was formerly a leper. And he said, "I am a poor man, a miskin, who lost all means of livelihood while I was on a journey. So none will satisfy my need except Allah and then you." The word miskin means faqir, who is poor. And this is if they are used separately. If they are used together, then a faqir is poorer than the miskin. The word miskin comes from iskan, which means to humiliate or to make someone lowly. This is because his poverty has made him lowly and humiliated. And on the opposite end, we normally find that the rich people are proud and arrogant, and they see themselves to be strong and powerful, and they are normally haughty. The word used in the Arabic for traveler is Ibn Sabil, literally the son of the way. The word Ibn, son, is normally talking about someone who sticks to something else. So the son of the way is the traveler, because he is always remaining on the road of his journey. The birds which fly over the water and they keep with the water, they are called Ibnul Ma, the son of the water, because they keep with the water all the time. So when you keep with someone, you become the Ibn or the son. So the angel here is asking this former leper that he needs some wealth to return him back to his land. And the angel said, "In the name of him who has given you such a nice and good skin and so much property, I ask you to give me a camel so that I may reach my destination." So the man replied, "I have many obligations," meaning to say, "I need this wealth to perform many obligatory duties, and you're not the only one who needs my wealth." So in giving this answer, he is pretending to forget that it is Allah Jalla wa'ala the one who gave him all this wealth, and also removed him of his leprosy. The angel said, "I think I know you. Were you not a leper to whom the people had a strong aversion? Weren't you a poor man, and then Allah enriched you with all this property?" So here the angel is reminding him of the favors and grace of Allah Jalla wa'ala on this man, so that hopefully he might remember and be generous with his wealth. But this man replied, "No, this is not true. I have been given this property through inheritance," meaning from my forefathers. The angel replied, "If you are telling a lie, then may Allah make you as you were before." Notice here how the angel said, "If you are telling a lie," whereas we know, reading this story, that the angel knows that he's telling a lie. So why did the angel use the word "if"? The angel is simply using a concordist approach in this argument. So it's like he's saying, if for argument's sake, we assume that I have no reason to believe that you're lying, then if you are lying, may Allah restore you to your previous condition. In a similar fashion, we find in the Quran, in Surah An-Naml, Ayah 59, Allah Jalla wa'ala says, Allahu khayrun amma yushrikun. Is Allah better or what you associate partners? Whereas Allah Jalla wa'ala knows that there is no comparison between Allah and their false gods. But this is just a type of argument in which you let your opponent have it his way, and then you take the argument from there. Then the angel went to the bald man, or the former bald man, and the angel himself was in the appearance of a bald man. And he asked the person the same question, and this person gave exactly the same answer as the former leper. And the angel replied, "If you are telling a lie, then may Allah restore you to your previous condition." So we find up to now that both of the former leper and the former bald person were ungrateful for the ni'mah of Allah Jalla wa'ala. And they said that this wealth has been given to us by our forefathers. It has been inherited. So they're not giving any credit to Allah Jalla wa'ala. Likewise, giving Allah no credit for their good health. Then the angel went to the former blind man, and he told him, "I am a poor person who is a traveler, and my means of livelihood have been exhausted while on my journey, and I have no one to return me back to my land except Allah and then you. So I ask you in the name of the one who has given you back your eyesight to give me a sheep so that with its help I can complete my journey." This third man, the former blind man, however, answered differently. He said, "No doubt I was a blind man and Allah gave me back my eyesight." So this man proved himself to be grateful because he acknowledged with his heart that this is a ni'mah from Allah, both his wealth and his health. And he also said it with his tongue and he performed the righteous actions with his limbs. He said, "So take anything you wish from my property. By Allah, I will not stop you from taking anything you need of my property, which you may take for the sake of Allah. Take what you want and leave what you want." So we find here that this man, the former blind man, has fulfilled the three ingredients of ash-shukr, which his other two companions did not fulfill. So the angel replied, "Keep your property with you. You three men have been tested, and Allah is pleased with you and is angry with your two companions." And the reason for this is obvious, because the first two, the leper and the bald, proved themselves to be ingrates, and the blind proved himself to be grateful. So we find that the pleasure of Allah and the anger of Allah revolves around whether you are an ingrate or grateful. This is a heartfelt hadith from which we can take many benefits. And from them, number one, that the Prophet ﷺ would narrate to us stories from the people of the past, just as we find in the Qur'an, so that we may take admonition and we may copy those who are righteous and avoid the mistakes of those before us. Because the wise person is the one who learns from the mistakes of others. And in this also there is evidence for those who say that the Sharia of those who were before us is the same Sharia as ours, as long as there is nothing in our Sharia which contradicts their Sharia. And this is the correct opinion. And when mentioning the prophets of the past, Allah Jalla wa'ala says, "Ulaika alladhina hadallahu fabihudahum muqtadih." Those are the ones Allah guided, so with their guidance take your example. So their Sharia is the same as our Sharia, unless we have a text to prove otherwise. Number two, we learn the ability of Allah Jalla wa'ala to heal the leper, the bald and the blind through the medium of the angel simply touching them. Number three, that the angels can assume human form. And this is clearly taken from the hadith, but the angels cannot do this by their own will, rather it is only with the permission of Allah. Number four, we also take that the angels are bodies and not just purely souls. And some deviants say that the angels actually is just a power or some energy. No, rather, angels are bodies. We don't know how they look like, but they are bodies made out of light. Number five, we also take that the narrators of a hadith would take great care in narrating the hadith word for word perfect. How do we know this? Because we find in the narration that Ishaq, the sub-narrator, was hesitant whether the man said camel or cows. So he included both of these words. So if they were unsure about something or some word, then they would make mention of it. Number six, we also take that if Allah decrees some kind of calamity for you, then it is not an obligation to be content with this calamity or rida, but rather it is an obligation to be patient with it. And when it comes to calamities, there are four levels. Number one, al-jaza', which is not being patient, and this is haram. Number two is al-sabr, being patient, and this is wajib. Number three is al-rida, being content, and this is when you do not feel the pain of the calamity. So it's all the same to you, you're content. And we find that the leper, bald and blind, they were not content with their situation. So they wanted Allah to remove them of this calamity. And the fourth level is ash-shukr, which is being thankful to Allah for this calamity, because he knows that in the long run this is actually better for him. Very few people will reach this level, but if you can be one of them, أَوْ لِسْمَ أَكْرَمَكَ اللَّهُ, who reaches this level, then so much the merrier. And the only way to reach this level of ash-shukr is to have firm 100% faith that this calamity is actually good for you. Just like the bitter pill which you have to take, it's bitter and you hate it, but you know that this is your medicine and it is actually good for you. And so this person actually sees this calamity as a ni'mah. And we know that when you have a ni'mah, then you should be thankful for this ni'mah. And this is what this chapter is all about. So the shakir actually sees his calamities as a ni'mah, even though it is painful. And these four levels are to do with the maqdoor, that which has been willed, meaning the actual event which Allah wills. As for the qadr, and we spoke about the difference before, then this is the action of Allah. These four levels don't apply to the qadr, because as for the qadr, then it is an obligation to be content with it. Why is this? Because we know that qadr is from the actions of Allah. And the actions of Allah are all good, and are all based upon hikmah, wisdom. Otherwise they would never have occurred. But as for that which is decreed, the actual event or the calamity itself, then we can say that these four levels apply to the calamity. As for what Allah Jalla wa Ala decrees in the Sharia, meaning the religious affairs and rulings, then there's no doubt you must be content with them, because it is an obligation to be content with the Islamic rulings. Because hating any part of the Sharia ruling is from the traits of the kuffar, which will have all your deeds null and void. As Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا فَتَعْسَلْ لَهُمْ وَأَضَلَّ أَعْمَالَهُمْ. And those who disbelieve, destruction is for them, and he has made their deeds gone to waste. ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّهُمْ كَرِهُ مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ فَأَحْبَطَ أَعْمَالَهُمْ. That is because they hated what Allah has sent down, so he made their deeds to be futile. And what Allah has sent down are the laws of the Sharia. So anyone who hates the laws of the Sharia and is not content with it, then his deeds will go to waste. And if your deeds go to waste, then this is another way of saying that you are a kafir outside the fold of Al-Islam. Because Allah Jalla wa Ala never wastes the deeds of a Muslim. وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُضِيعَ إِيمَانَكُمْ. And Allah was not so as to waste your iman. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُضِيعُ أَجْرَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Verily Allah does not waste the reward of those who do good. Point number 7. We take that it is permissible to make a dua and give a condition to this dua. This is taken from the statement of the angel, إِن كُنْتَ كَاذِبًا فَصَيَّرَكَ اللَّهُ إِلَى مَا كُنْتَ. If you are lying, then may Allah turn you back to your previous condition. Likewise, we take this ruling from the Qur'an in the case of Al-Li'an, when Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَالْخَامِسَةُ أَنَّ لَعْنَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ إِن كَانَ مِنَ الْكَاذِبِينَ. And the fifth testimony that, may the curse of Allah be upon him, if he is from those who is lying. Likewise, the woman says, وَالْخَامِسَةَ أَنَّ غَضَبَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهَا إِن كَانَ مِنَ الصَّادِقِينَ. And the fifth testimony, that may the anger of Allah be upon her, if he is from those who is speaking the truth. And also we take it from the dua of Al-Istikhara, Allahumma in kunta ta'lam, up until the end of the dua. Oh Allah, if you know that such and such an affair is good for me, up until the end of the dua. Number 8, the permissibility of using a concordist approach. So this is like when you say, for the sake of argument. So for the sake of argument, you will let go of what you are believing and go down to the level of your opponent in the argument. And you take the argument from there. And we take this because the angel knew that the first two people were lying, because he is the one who touched them and cured them by the permission of Allah. But still he said, if you are telling a lie, then may Allah restore you to your previous condition. And we also have examples from this in the Qur'an. In Surah As-Saba, he says, وَإِنَّا أَوْ إِيَّاكُمْ لَعَلَى هُدًى أَوْ فِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. It is either us or you who are upon guidance or plain error. In actual fact, we know that this choice doesn't actually exist, because there is no doubt that the kuffar are upon plain error and the Muslims are upon guidance. But this is a case of where you let go of your own beliefs and you take the argument from your opponent's standpoint of view. And so this ayah cannot be taken that the Prophet was in doubt as to whether the Muslims are upon guidance or the non-Muslims are upon guidance. But rather the Prophet, just for the sake of the argument, let go of his belief and took it from the opponent's standpoint of view. Number 9, we can take that when it comes to al-barakah and your wealth being blessed, then really there is no end to it. This is because each of these three men, the leper, the bald and the blind, were given a valley of camels, cows, and sheep. So always ask Allah Jalla wa Ala and make dua to bless your wealth, just like the angel did to these three men. Issue number 10, we ask ourselves the question, if an angel makes a dua, is it necessary that it will be answered, just as it was in this story? What seems apparent is that we cannot take a general rule from this, and that in this story it was just a particular case where the dua of the angel was answered. But it is not apparent from this story that we can extract a general rule that the dua of the angel is definitely answered. Point 11, we learn a valuable lesson about ash-shukr, being grateful. Broadly speaking, ash-shukr is when you obey the one who has conferred a bounty upon you. So if Allah Jalla wa Ala has given you wealth, then from your shukr is to spend some of this wealth in the way of Allah. If He has granted you knowledge, then from your shukr is to impart this knowledge on other people. So the type of your shukr would depend on the type of ni'mah. Number 12, the permissibility of acting. This is because the angel came in the form of a leper. We know that the angel is not a leper, so he was acting. Likewise with the bald man and the blind man. And so acting is permissible if there is a benefit in this. Because we see that this angel came in the form of a leper, bald and blind, and this was in order to test these three men. And so in this there was a benefit. So if there is a benefit, then you can act. Point 13, that when Allah tests you, He can test the whole people, or the whole nation as a whole. And this is because Allah Jalla wa Ala tested all three of these people, and not just any one particular amongst them. Number 14, we take the virtue of az-zuhd, which is when you leave off in this world that which will not benefit you in the hereafter. And so we find the blind man was a zahid, the one who practiced az-zuhd, because he was willing to give all of his wealth to this angel who came to him in the form of a blind man. Number 15, we find that there is evidence that the nations before us used to inherit from each other. And this is because the first two people said that this is the wealth which I have inherited from my forefathers. So this idea of inheritance is nothing new to this Sharia. Number 16, we take that al-ridha, pleasure, and al-sakhat, anger, and al-irada, wanting, are all from the characteristics of Allah. We have discussed that al-irada is of two types, irada kawniya and irada shari'iyya. Kawniya must take place, but it is not necessarily beloved to Allah. Shari'iyya does not have to take place, but it is always beloved to Allah. So kawniya is basically al-mashi'ah, and shari'iyya is basically al-mahabba. And it is important to realize here that if some evil takes place, then it can never be attributed to Allah Jalla wa Ala. Meaning to say the actions of Allah, because the actions of Allah are never evil, they are always good. Even though the event which takes place on earth or the heavens may be evil from one angle. The reason why every action of Allah is good is because it comes out from hikmah, which is wisdom, and rahmah, which is mercy. This is why the Prophet ﷺ would say in one of his du'a, الْخَيْرُ كُلُّهُ فِي يَدَيْكَ وَالشَّرُّ لَيْسَ إِلَيْكَ. The goodness, all of it is in your hands, and evil is not ascribed to you. As for the creation of Allah, the event which takes place, then in this creation there can be evil and there can be good. So nothing is purely evil. For example, illness. It could be evil from one angle, but good from another angle. And then you can make your analogy with all other events. They may seem to be evil from one angle, but there is always a wisdom behind them. Sometimes we know this wisdom and sometimes we do not. The rida and sakhat of Allah Jalla wa Ala are based upon hikmah, which is wisdom. So it does not resemble our pleasure and our anger. When humans are pleased with someone, they may overlook his faults. And when they are angry with someone, they may overlook his good deeds. So we could go to one end of the extreme. As for the anger and pleasure of Allah, they are all based upon wisdom. And only those who deserve it will receive his pleasure, and those who deserve it will receive his anger. People of At-Tahrif have said that the pleasure of Allah actually means Him rewarding someone or Him wanting to reward someone. So they are explaining this word with what it necessitates. Because if Allah is pleased with you, then this necessitates that He will reward you. But they are not the same thing. He is pleased with you and then thereafter He will reward you. But to say that His pleasure equals His reward, this is wrong. And there is no evidence for this. And if they had meant the same thing, then we know that Allah Jalla wa Ala is able to express Himself clearly. And He would have told us that it means that He wants to reward somebody. Number 17. When the angel said that Allah is pleased with you and is angry with your two companions, this does not mean that all three of them were together, meaning physically together, but rather he called them your companions because they were dealt in the same way. So they were companions from that sense, not that they were physically together. Number 18. That when Allah confers a favor upon you or a ni'mah, He is going to test you. And this is clear enough to see from the narration. Number 19. That reminding somebody of someone or something could be done verbally or with your actions or with your appearance. And this is because the angel came to the leper in the form of a leper to remind him that you were once a leper as well. And he also informed him afterwards verbally, were you not a leper and then Allah cured you and you were poor and Allah enriched you? So this is a verbal reminding. The point is, however the reminder can be done, then it should be done, because the reminder will benefit the believers. Number 20, it is permissible for somebody to attribute something to himself, which is not the case in reality, in order to test someone. And this is because the angel came to these people and he said that I am a poor person on a journey and I have lost all my wealth because of this journey. Is this true? No, it is not true. He is not a poor person and neither is he on a journey. But he said this and he attributed to himself that he is poor and on a journey in order to examine these people. So you can attribute to yourself something which is not in reality the case for the sake of testing somebody. Number 21. That this story back then was well known and famous because the angel said, فَقَدْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْكَ وَالسَّخِطَ عَلَىٰ صَاحِبَيْكَ. Allah is pleased with you and is angry with your companions. So it is as if he knew who his companions were and what they were suffering and the blessings which they enjoyed thereafter. It is clear for us to see why the Shaykh included this story in this chapter. It gives us an example of how to be thankful to Allah and an example of how not to be thankful to Allah Jalla wa'ala. Issues in this chapter. Issue number 1. The tafsir of the ayah in Surah Al-Fussilat. And we spoke about this. Issue number 2. The meaning of لَيَقُولَنَّ هَذَا لِي. He will surely say, this is for me. And the meaning is that this wealth is for me or this ni'mah is for me because I am worthy of it. And Allah knows this. This is why He gave it to me, because of my worth. Issue number 3. The meaning of the statement, إِنَّمَا أُوتِيتُهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ عِنْدِي. I have been only given this because of knowledge which I have. Again, giving his own knowledge the credit, without realizing that his knowledge itself is a ni'mah from Allah. Issue number 4. The great lessons hidden in this wonderful story which is quoted. The points of benefit which we mention from the story are not even all of the benefits that can be extracted. But the story points out the difference between these three men. As for the leper and the bald, they denied the ni'mah of Allah and were ungrateful to Allah Jalla wa'ala. As for the blind man, then this is an example of how to be grateful. He gave the credit to Allah and as a thanks to Allah Jalla wa'ala, he was prepared to give the whole of his wealth to this angel who came to him in the form of a blind man. End of chapter. Question number 1. The ayah from Surah Al-Fussilat. What has this ayah got to do with Kitab al-Tawheed? Question number 2. Explain the three ingredients of Ash-Shukr. Question number 3. In the story about the leper, the bald and the blind, we mentioned 21 points of benefit. Read through the story again and take out as many points of benefit as you can. You can repeat the ones we have repeated, and if you can find more, which we haven't mentioned, then this is even better. Let's move on to chapter number 50, and this is about giving yourself or others names which indicate a servitude to other than Allah. And the author uses the ayah as the title. So the ayah he quotes from Surah Al-A'raf number 190. فَلَمَّا آتَاهُمَا صَالِحًا جَعَلَا لَهُ شُرَكَاءَ فِي مَا آتَاهُمَا فَتَعَالَ اللَّهُ عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ. Actually, this ayah on its own will not make sense until you read the ayah before it. So we're going to have to take it from ayah number 189. He says, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ. He has created you from a single soul. وَجَعَلَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا لِيَسْكُنَ إِلَيْهَا. And from the soul he has made a partner so that he can live in tranquility with her. Either we can understand this to mean that he created Adam first of all, so this is the single soul, and then for him he created his wife Hawa, because Hawa was created from the rib of Adam. The other way we can understand it is that the nafs does not refer to a single person like Adam alayhi salam, Rather, it refers to the category of mankind. So from this nafs, or from mankind, he created their wives. So their wives are from mankind. They are not from other than mankind. So we could understand the word nafs to be referring to Adam, or we could understand it to be referring to the humankind. As Allah Jalla wa Ala says in Surah Ali Imran, لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah bestowed a great favor on the believers when He sent to them a messenger min anfusihim, from themselves, meaning from their type. So their messenger was of the same type as the humans. So the messenger was not an angel or a jinn or some other alien creature. He was from their own type. As for him saying, لِيَسْكُنَ إِلَيْهَا, we could take this to mean so that he may find tranquility with her, because Allah Jalla wa Ala puts love and compassion and mercy between the husband and the wife. Or we could carry the meaning to him fulfilling his desires. So in this case, it is specific between the husband and the wife when they carry out their conjugal relations. And perhaps the second meaning is the stronger meaning in relation to the context, because the ayah continues, فَلَمَّا تَغَشَّاهَا حَمَلَتْ حَمْلًا خَفِيفًا فَمَرَّتْ بِهِ. So when he covered her, meaning had intercourse with her. So Allah Jalla wa Ala uses the word تَغَشَّى, which means to cover her. It's another way of saying had intercourse with her. And this is out of modesty, because to say it clearly and explicitly is something that humans might find a little repulsive. And this is a theme you find in the Qur'an. For example, Allah Jalla wa Ala says in Surah Al-Nisa, أَوْ لَامَسْتُمُ النِّسَى, or you have touched the women. He actually means you have intercourse with the women. Of course, when the situation requires, then you're going to have to say it explicitly. For example, if a person commits zina and he's taken to the court, then there's no doubt he's going to have to say this explicitly. And the reason for this is because there is a punishment if he is found guilty. And we know that the had punishments need to be avoided whenever there is any doubt. Similarly, the Prophet ﷺ said in the authentic hadith, إِذَا جَلَسَ بَيْنَ شُعْبِهَا الْأَرْبَعُ ثُمَّ جَهَدَهَا فَقَدْ وَجَبَ الْغُسْلُ. When he sits between her four limbs and then strives against her, then ghusl is wajib. So this is another way of saying when he has intercourse with her, because he is in between her four limbs. So the ayah says that she carries a light load, and this is when she becomes pregnant. And she is able to move about and walk because it is light, so there's no difficulty on her. فَلَمَّا أَثْقَلَتْ دَعْوَ اللَّهَ رَبَّهُمَا لَإِنْ آتَيْتَنَا صَالِحًا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الشَّاكِرِينَ. And when the load becomes heavy, they call upon Allah, their Lord, if you give us a righteous child. And salih in this case means a sound child, one who is healthy and not deformed. And salih can also mean one who is righteous in his deen. So salih both in his physical appearance and in his deen. These are two different meanings, but they're not contradictory, so we can accept both meanings. So they say, if you give us a salih child, we will surely be grateful. Then the next ayah is what the Shaykh quotes as his evidence. فَلَمَّا آتَاهُمَا صَالِحًا جَعَلَا لَهُ شُرَكَاءَ فِي مَا آتَاهُمَا فَتَعَالَ اللَّهُ عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ. So when he gives them this righteous child, they ascribe partners with Allah in that which he has given them. So exalted be Allah above all that they ascribe partners with him. So what is apparent from this, that as soon as this child is born, they ascribe partners, which basically means that the stronger tafsir is that the word salih means not salih in the religion, but rather salih in the physical appearance. Because as soon as the baby is born, you do not know whether he is righteous in his deen or not. And this is what happens when people make a contract with Allah Jalla wa Ala, that if you do this for me, I will be grateful and I will do certain acts of worship for you. As we can see in this ayah, that when Allah gave them this sound child, they ascribed partners instead of thanking Allah Jalla wa Ala. Similarly, we find in Surah At-Tawbah, وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ عَاهَدَ اللَّهَ لَإِنْ آتَانَا مِنْ فَضْلِهِ لَنَصَّدَّقَنَّ وَلَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ فَلَمَّا آتَاهُمْ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ بَخِلُوا بِهِ وَتَوَلَّوا وَهُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ. And from them are those who make a contract with Allah that if you were to give us from your bounty, we would surely give charity and we will surely be from the righteous. And when He, meaning Allah, gives them from His bounty, they are stingy and they turn away from righteous deeds in aversion. So previously they made a contract with Allah, then when Allah gives them what they wanted, Behold, they fail to fulfill their side of the bargain. And from this it becomes known to us that an-nadhr or vows should not be made. This is when somebody says, if Allah makes me pass my exams, or He cures me from this illness, then for Allah against me is that I will spend 1 week in i'tikaf. So you're striking a deal with Allah Jalla wa'ala, as if you would not perform these acts of worship unless Allah gives you what you want. And normally people fail to live up to their side of the bargain, because they can talk the talk, but they cannot walk the walk. And the Prophet ﷺ in the Sahih said about an-nadhr, إِنَّهُ لَا يَرُدُّ شَيْئًا وَإِنَّمَا يُسْتَخْرَجُ بِهِ مِنَ الْبَخِيلِ. It does not repel anything, meaning the nadhr will not change your destiny. It only extracts from the wealth of the stingy person. So either this could be extracting his wealth, or even extracting good deeds from him. So it's like he would never do a good deed except if Allah gives him something in return. And so many ulama have said that it is haram to make an-nadhr, and some others have said that it is makruh. So with an-nadhr, you are simply putting upon yourself difficulty, and things which were not originally wajib for you, you are making them wajib upon yourself. So the question now is, how are these two people making shirk with this child which they have been given? The first way we could understand it is that they are saying that this child came because of such and such a dead saint. And so this is shirk akbar, because they are saying that there is a creator other than Allah. And we can find a similar thing nowadays. A woman is not able to give birth, so she will go to the grave of a dead saint and make dua to this grave and ask this dead person to provide her with a child. And no doubt making dua to anyone other than Allah in something which is specific to Allah, this is shirk akbar. Because this person in this case is thinking that this dead saint has the ability to change or influence the affairs of creation. And this is major shirk. The second way to look at it is if they give the credit for the health of this child to the doctors or those carers of the baby. So they might say that this baby is very healthy because the doctors looked after it very well. So this is a type of shirk, but it is not shirk akbar, because they are giving credit to a sabab which is a legitimate sabab. But because they are not giving credit to Allah, then it is as if they are putting the doctors or the carers on the same level as Allah. So it becomes shirk asghar. The third way of looking at it is that they give Allah Jalla wa'ala the credit for this baby to be healthy, but they put this baby on the same level as Allah in terms of their love, and they allow this child to distract them from the remembrance of Allah and the obedience of Allah. As we find in Surah At-Taghabun, إِنَّمَا أَمْوَالُكُمْ وَأَوْلَادُكُمْ فِتْنَةٌ وَاللَّهُ عِنْدَهُ أَجْرٌ عَظِيمٌ. Your wealth and your children are only a trial, and with Allah is a great reward. Likewise in Surah Al-Munafiqun, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُلْهِكُمْ أَمْوَالُكُمْ وَلَا أَوْلَادُكُمْ عَنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْخَاسِرُونَ. O you who believe, let not your wealth or your children divert you from the remembrance of Allah, and whoever does that, then they are the losers. So we find from the ayah that Allah Jalla wa'ala clearly says that when He gives them the righteous child, meaning sound in his body and health, they associate partners with him. So may Allah be removed away from what they associate. He is far high and removed above the false deities and all other types of false gods. So if we take this ayah to mean that it is referring to Adam and Hawa, then we are saying that they both committed shirk when they were given a child. So some scholars say that this is not shirk in terms of worship, but this is shirk in terms of obedience. So this child distracted them from the obedience. But this is a weak tafsir, and rather the stronger version of this tafsir is that when he says, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَفْسٍ وَاحِدًا, He is the one who created you from one nafs, it means مِن جِنْسٍ وَاحِدٍ, from one type, meaning the humankind type. So it is not referring to Adam. There is a third opinion in this. They say when he says, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَفْسٍ وَاحِدًا, He is the one who created you from one nafs, then this is referring to Adam. وَجَعَلَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا لِيَسْكُنَ إِلَيْهَا, and he made from this nafs its wife that he may find tranquility with her. This is talking about Hawa. Then they say, when he says, فَلَمَّا تَغَشَّاهَا حَمَلَتْ حَمْلًا خَفِيفًا فَمَرَّتْ بِهِ, when he covered her, she carried a light load and moved and passed by with it. They say this part is referring to the type of man. So it's not referring particularly to Adam, but it's referring to mankind. So when the man covered his wife, speaking in a general sense. And so this is why Allah Jalla wa'ala ends off ayah number 190 by saying, فَتَعَالَى اللَّهُ عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ. So may Allah be removed from that which they make shirk with. So yushrikun is in the plural sense, it is not in the dual sense. So it's not yushrikani, which would refer to two people committing shirk. They say that there is a similar ayah in the Qur'an, in Surah Al-Mu'minun. He says, وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ مِنْ سُلَالَةٍ مِنْ طِينَ ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَاهُ نُطُفَةً فِي قَرَارٍ مَكِينَ. We created mankind from an extract of mud, and then we made him as a drop of liquid in a firm and secure place, meaning the womb. So the first part of the ayah talks about mankind being made from mud. So this is referring to Adam alayhi salam, and then it moves on to talking about the type of man, meaning the jinns, or the category of man, because this category of man is made from a drop of liquid in the womb and not from teen. So it switches from Adam to his progeny. And they say that this ayah of the chapter is the same thing. It begins talking about Adam and Hawa, and then it switches to their progeny. And so from this, you escape from saying that Adam and Hawa committed shirk. And this third tafsir is understandable. And they say that the ayah finishes by saying, فَتَعَالَ اللَّهُ عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ. May Allah be removed from that which they associate partners. And it is in the plural sense, it's not in the dual sense, because it's talking about the category of male and category of female. But of course there are many females and there are many males. So it makes plural in total. It's a bit like when Allah Jalla wa'ala says, وَإِن ضَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ قَتَتَلُوا فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا. And if two parties of the believers fight each other, then make peace between them. So the word for fight is اِقْتَتَلُوا. It is not اِقْتَتَلَا in the dual sense. So he's talking about two parties, but the word for fight is in the plural sense, اِقْتَتَلُوا. Because even though there are two parties, but the ones who are fighting are many, more than just two. So they say that it's the same thing in this case. The ayah is talking about the category of male and female, and it ends off by saying yushrikun, which is plural, because there are many males and many females. This tafsir is understandable, but the first tafsir is simpler. You simply say that nafs is referring to the category of man. So it is man in general, and it is not referring to Adam from the very beginning. Next, the author, rahimahullah, says that Ibn Hazm said that the ulama are agreed upon the fact that it is haram to name anyone with a name which means a servitude to anyone other than Allah, such as Abd Umar, the slave of Umar, or Abdul Ka'bah, the slave of the Ka'bah, and names which are similar to them, except Abdul Muttalib. End quote. Somebody might say, but what about the hadith which we mentioned when the Prophet ﷺ said, Ta'isa Abdul Dinar, Ta'isa Abdul Dirham, Ta'isa Abdul Khamila, Ta'isa Abdul Khamisa. So we say that this is not a name, but rather he is just describing the slave of the dinar and dirham and the bed and the expensive garment. Ibn Hazm said that Abdul Muttalib, this name is allowed. And he takes his evidence from the hadith when the Prophet ﷺ said, أَنَا النَّبِيُّ لَا كَذِبْ أَنَا إِبْنُ عَبْدِ الْمُطَّلِبِ. I am the Prophet and that's no lie. I am the son of Abdul Muttalib. And we know that Abdul Muttalib was the grandfather of the Prophet. However, the correct opinion is that it is not permissible to name anybody Abdul Muttalib. And the reason the Prophet ﷺ said, I am the son of Abdul Muttalib, is that he is just giving this information that he is the son of Abdul Muttalib. He is not saying it is permissible to name somebody Abdul Muttalib. And clearly we have many examples in which the Prophet ﷺ in many ahadith gives certain pieces of information, but he does not say whether it is halal or haram. Likewise, the Prophet ﷺ said in relation to distributing the fifth of the ghanima as well as the fay, which are the spoils of the war, we know that a share of it goes to the family members of the Prophet. And his family members are Banu Hashim, the son of Hashim. Hashim was the brother of Muttalib. إِنَّمَا بَنُ هَاشِمْ وَبَنُ عَبْدِ الْمُطَّلِبْ شَيْءٌ وَاحِدٌ. That Banu Hashim and Banu Abdul Muttalib are one and the same. So here again in this hadith he uses the word Abdul Muttalib. But this is just by way of giving the information that this tribe is called Banu Abdul Muttalib. Likewise, we know in the hadith in the Sahih, the Prophet ﷺ said, يَا بَنِي عَبْدِ مَنَافِ لَا تَمْنَعُ أَحَدًا طاف بهذا البيت أو صلى في أي ساعة شاء من ليل أو نهار. أو بني عبد مناف, do not prevent anyone from making tawaf around the house or praying at any time during the day or night. So he uses the word عبد مناف, the slave of مناف. But he is not saying that it is permissible to name your children or anyone else عبد مناف, because مناف is not one of the names of Allah. Likewise, المطلب is not one of the names of Allah. Therefore, you cannot use the word عبد in front of it. And so we find the only time you can have the word عبد is if it comes before one of the established names of Allah. Then the Shaykh quotes the tafsir of the ayah given by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, and this narration is ضعيف, so cannot be accepted as evidence. But he is reported to have said that when Adam had sexual relations with Hawa, she became pregnant. And then Iblis came to them and said, I am the one who caused your expulsion from Jannah. So you must obey me, otherwise I will cause your child to grow two horns like a deer, by which he will puncture your belly when he comes out. I will surely do it, I will surely do it. So Iblis frightened them and he ordered them to name their child Abdul Harith. And Harith, we know, is not from the names of Allah. So therefore it is not permissible to name anybody Abdul Harith. But this is what Shaytan ordered them in this narration. But Adam and Hawa did not obey Iblis, and a dead child was born to them. Then when she became pregnant a second time round, Iblis repeated this demand. But again they did not obey, and again the child was born dead. Then when she became pregnant the third time round, again Iblis made the same demand, and on this occasion they named the boy Abdul Harith. And this refers to the ayah when Allah says, جَعَلَا لَهُ شُرَكَاءَ فِي مَا آتَاهُمَا. They made partners with him for what they were given. So we find that they made shirk in obedience, not in worship, because they obeyed Shaytan in what constitutes disobedience to Allah. And Ibn Abi Hatim, who reported this first story, also reports from Qatada, one of the Mufassirin, that he said that they made partners in giving obedience along with him, but not in worship besides him. And this is as we have just mentioned. Also, Ibn Abi Hatim reports from Mujahid regarding the ayah, لَإِنْ آتَيْتَنَا صَالِحًا, if you give us a righteous child, meaning righteous in his health. He says that they, meaning Adam and Hawa, were frightened that the child might not be human. And he says this was also mentioned by Hassan al-Basri, Sa'id and others from the Mufassirin. What we know from al-Hassan al-Basri, as in Tafsir ibn Kathir, is that al-Hassan al-Basri rahimahullah, his opinion was that this ayah is talking about the mushrikeen from Banu Adam, and it is not talking about Adam and Hawa. In any case, this story is false and can be argued against from many angles. Firstly, there's nothing authentic from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam in regards to this story. And a story like this could only be known from revelation. And Ibn Hazm said that this story is one of the superstitious type of narrations, which are fabricated and a complete lie. Secondly, if we say that this story is true, then it poses a problem. Adam and Hawa therefore committed shirk. So either they died upon shirk, in which case this is a great matter, because then you're saying that one of the prophets died upon shirk. This is not an easy statement to make, and it is one of the most heretical types of statements. Or if he did not die upon shirk, then he made tawbah from this shirk. So if that's the case, then why didn't Allah Jalla wa'ala send down some information telling us that they made tawbah? In the same way, when he told us that Adam ate from the tree from which he was prohibited, he made tawbah afterwards, and this is well documented in the Qur'an. And the dua they made also is well documented, when they said, رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. So the point is that this story doesn't follow the style of the story in which Allah Jalla wa'ala narrates about the prophets. Thirdly, this story is telling us that the prophet committed shirk. And we know from the ulama that they are agreed upon the fact that it is impossible for a prophet, after receiving the prophethood and the message, to commit shirk. They may commit minor mistakes, they are only humans, but to commit any form of shirk, this is not possible. And Allah has protected every prophet from committing shirk, as well as committing major sins. As for minor sins, which do not detract from his prophethood, then this is possible for a prophet. So we say that a prophet cannot commit sins which will show him to be a liar, or devious or a cheater or using some underhand tactics to deceive people. Because if that's the case, then this man cannot be trusted as a prophet. How do we know that what he's telling us is not a lie if it is possible for him to commit a lie? So these types of sins, as well as major sins and shirk, then Allah has protected all the prophets from these types of sins. Fourthly, we know from the hadith of the Ash-Shafa'atul Uzma that the people will go to the prophets to seek intercession, and Adam alayhi salam will not intercede for the people, and he will remember his sin of eating from the tree. But eating from the tree is not shirk and is not as serious as the sin which is mentioned in this fabricated narration. So if this narration was true, then surely the sin which he has committed in this narration would be more worthy for Adam alayhi salam to feel shy of. Fifthly, the story mentions that Shaytan came to them and he said, "I am your companion who took you out from Jannah." If Shaytan wanted to deceive them again, why would he let them know that he is their companion who took them out from Jannah? Because if he says this, then Adam and Hawa will be on guard against him and will certainly not listen to him. So it doesn't make sense from that angle. Sixthly, Iblis says that "I will make your child to have two horns." So either Adam and Hawa believed him. In this case, this would be clear shirk, because we know that nobody is able to do this except Allah. Or they did not believe him. So if they did not believe him, then why would they obey him in the first place? And seventhly, we know that the ayah is not referring to Adam and Hawa, because Allah ends it by saying, "فَتَعَالَى اللَّهُ عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ." So may Allah be removed from that which they make shirk with. And as we said before, this is in the plural sense. It is not in the dual sense. If it was referring to Adam and Hawa, it would be فَتَعَالَى اللَّهُ عَمَّا يُشْرِكَانَ. So we find from all of this that this story is batil, both in its meaning and even in its chain of narration is weak, as Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah graded it to be da'if. Issues in this chapter. Issue number 1, any name which implies worship of others besides Allah is forbidden. And there is an ijma' on this issue, and an ijma' can be used as an evidence. So you can give a ruling, and if you're asked what is the evidence, it is permissible to say the evidence is the ijma' of the ulama. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, "Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu ati'u Allah wa ati'u ar-rasul wa ulil amri minkum fa in tanaza'tum fi shay'in farudduhu ila Allah wa ar-rasul in kuntum tu'minuna billahi wal yawmil akhir dhalika khayrun wa ahsanu ta'wila." Surah An-Nisa ayah 59. But the shahid from this ayah: if you disagree or dispute about anything, then return it to Allah and the Messenger, which basically means if you do not dispute about anything, then you do not need to return it to Allah and the Messenger. And so if that's the case, then there is no need to dispute and the issue is over. However, nowadays it is very difficult to find an ijma'. And Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah said that the ijma', which we know is an ijma', is that which took place during the first 3 generations. Because after that, the ummah became widespread and the differences of opinion became much. So it is difficult to form an ijma'. And Al-Imam Ahmad rahimahullah said, when he rebuked the idea that there could be an ijma', he said, "What will make you know that perhaps they differed?" So how do you know there is an ijma'? Have you done a survey all across the world, taking into account every single alim, asking him about his opinion? How do you know that there is no difference of opinion? So he says that whoever claims that there is an ijma' on an issue, then he is a liar. So we find that the only ijma' which is a proper ijma' is the one which took place in the very early generations of Al-Islam. And it is also preceded that Abdul Muttalib, this name is also haram to be given. And we discussed this issue earlier on. Issue number 2, the tafsir of the ayah in Surah Al-A'raf. And we spoke about this. Issue number 3, this shirk is concerned only with the naming, even though its actual implied meaning is not intended. And the Shaykh has said this based on this narration of Abdullah ibn Abbas, which we refuted earlier on. What is correct is that this is real shirk in all its implied meaning. This is why Allah Jalla wa Ala says in the context of these ayat, أَيُشْرِكُونَ مَا لَا يَخْلُقُ شَيْئًا وَهُمْ يُخْلَقُونَ. Are they making partners with what does not create anything but himself is created? Issue number 4. The gift of Allah to a person of a normal girl, meaning a baby girl, is also from the favors of Allah. Because in the ayah when they said, لَئِنْ آتَيْتَنَا صَالِحًا if you give us a good or healthy child. So salihan is in the male sense. But the Shaykh is saying here that it makes no difference whether the baby is male or female. And a baby girl is also from the favors of Allah. And we know that the Arab used to bury their baby daughters alive because they would see it as more of a curse than a blessing. In Surah An-Nahl, ayah 58 and 59, وَإِذَا بُشِّرَ أَحَدُهُمْ بِالْأُنْثَى ظَلَّ وَجْهُهُ مُسْوَدًّا وَهُوَ كَظِيمٌ يَتَوَارَى مِنَ الْقَوْمِ مِنْ سُوءِ مَا بُشِّرَ بِهِ أَيُمْسِكُ عَلَى هُونٍ أَمْ يَدُسُّهُ فِي التُّرَابِ أَلَا سَاءَ مَا يَحْكُمُونَ. And when one of them is given the glad tidings of a female, his face becomes blackened because of the grief he is suppressing. He hides from the people because of the evil of what he has been given news of. He asks himself, should he keep this baby and be humiliated, or should he cover this baby in dust, meaning bury it alive? How evil is what they judge. Issue number 5, that the early Muslims made a difference between shirk in obedience and shirk in worship. What's the difference between the two? First of all, know that if your ta'ah, your obedience, is directed to Allah, then there is no difference between ta'ah, obedience, and ibadah, worship, because your ta'ah is ibadah if it is directed to Allah Jalla wa Ala. So if you're obeying Him, you're worshipping Him, and if you're worshipping Him, you are obeying Him. As for that obedience which is directed to other than Allah, then this is not worship necessarily, because we know that we obey, have ta'ah of the Prophet ﷺ, but we don't have his ibadah, his worship. So we obey him but don't worship him. Also, a person could obey one of the kings or rulers of this world, yet he might hate him at the same time. So shirk in obedience, or shirk in your atta'ah, is if you obey someone without loving him or giving him veneration or being lowly and humiliated to him in the same way you would to Allah Jalla wa Ala, but rather you obey him because he has ordered you in doing that which Allah has forbidden, then this is shirk in ta'ah. So if we look at this fabricated story, then they say that Adam and Hawa obeyed Shaytan, but they did not worship Shaytan. So they say that their shirk was in the ta'ah, obedience, not in ibadah. But of course we know that this story is fabricated, and even its meaning is batil. End of chapter. Question number 1. Ayah number 189 and 190 from Surah Al-A'raf has 3 tafaseer which we mentioned. Recall each of these tafaseer and then mention which one is closest to the truth. Question number 2. The ayah mentions that when they are given this righteous child, they make shirk. We mentioned 3 ways in which they commit shirk. Recall these 3 ways. Question number 3. We know that in the authentic hadith, the Prophet mentioned the words Abdul Muttalib and Abdul Manaf. Does this mean it is permissible to name your children with these names? Explain your answer. Question number 4. Explain why the story narrated from Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu is not correct. We mentioned 7 points. See if you can recall all of them.